Hi, today we're coming to you from historic Lewis, Delaware. We're going to meet famed photographer Kevin Fleming, who, if you know him from this area, you may not know how popular he really is. He is the most popular Kevin in the state, and he is also amazing at what he does. So stay tuned.
Hi, welcome to Miscellaneous Fitness. Everything from step mills to treadmills, arc trainers, ellipticals, upright bikes, recumbent bikes, and even a couple of rowers. At Miscellaneous Fitness, we have over 23 classes on the schedule every week, from body pump to kickboxing to boot camps, spin classes. We do small group training. We have personal training. We even offer judo jiu-jitsu program. We have a little bit of everything for everybody.
A master of farm-to-table cuisine, an award-winning duo of local ingredient brewing, join forces to create a culinary experience made from the best that Delaware has to offer. Brickworks Brewing and Eats in Smyrna, Delaware. A made-from-scratch fusion of Delaware's best, like glazed baby back ribs and apple jalapeno slaw. Paired with drop trowel, Brickworks exclusive unfiltered IPA. Brickworks Brewing and Eats in Smyrna, Delaware. Made from scratch, from plate to glass.
Hi, welcome back. We're in Lewis, Delaware today, and we're with Kevin Fleming, the owner of the several studios and acclaimed and the most famous Kevin in the state, from what I heard.
Some websites said I am one of the 50 most famous Kevins in Delaware, or in America.
In America.
And, I'm Delaware's most famous.
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you. Known you a long time.
Yeah. And actually, what kind of prompted this, we've been watching your career. I mean, for many years, and I don't think people realize what a hidden gem you are and what the studios offer here. And so we just wanted to kind of bring it out a little bit.
Yeah, I started out with photography at the State News and the News Journal, and worked there for 5 years, then National Geographic for 10 years. I've been on assignment in 28 countries in all 50 states. Done 27 books. My 28th book is at the printer right now.
My word.
And I have two galleries, one in Rehoboth and one in Lewis. Mm-hmm. And we sell my prints in Lewis and Rehoboth.
Right. Well, this is the first time I've been in this studio, and it's prime location right on 2nd Street.
It is. This is a great spot, right next to Touch of Italy.
Yeah.
And 2nd Street gets a lot of traffic in the summer.
Right. Now, you do it's a wide variety, but you said you were with National Geographic, so you do a lot with wild.
I did. At National Geographic, I kind of was a generalist, which was a good thing because you could do any kind of assignment. I didn't just do food photography or nature. Mm-hmm. In fact, there I did a story on Ulysses, which is the Homer's Odyssey, which is 2,000 years before Christ. Mm-hmm. And I did high-energy physics, which took me to all the high-energy labs around the world, like the CERN and Fermilab and all those places. China, Japan. Mm-hmm. I went from Baltimore, I think, that way and came back all the way around the other way.
Oh, really?
I've done that a couple times.
No kidding. Well, we were fortunate enough, because we knew each other. You love food.
I do love food, and as you can tell.
And me too. Yeah. Wearing my belly shirt, I was in Santa Rosa with my cousin. I think back in the Spuma days, you actually met him. He was kind of interning with me back in the day.
Probably.
And now he's phenomenal. He's actually he's the head chef of Linkin Park when they go on tour.
Oh, nice.
So that's kind of fun. Yeah. He's been also with every, you know, country known to man, you know, from Russia, China, Japan, you name it. But back in that day, you were in for dinner, and I was in need of some photographic type of material for some of my, you know, promotions and things. I asked you if you'd help me out, and you took probably the most spectacular picture of a paella dish, which then we ran for the next 5, 6, 7 years on pretty much anything.
Nice.
In fact, I think a lot of publications, Delaware Today and things like, you all use that photograph.
Uh-huh, good.
So do you do a lot of food photography?
Yeah, I actually did a cookbook for the Big Fish, which was, 200 pages of their recipes.
Right.
And it's really nice doing food because you can actually eat your subject.
Right.
You can't do that with wildlife and nature. pretty much everything here is within 5 miles of here.
Okay.
People here don't want to see Africa photographs and North Pole photographs on their wall. They want to see things they know and love and
right.
can relate to.
Yeah, and a lot of people here would have no clue that they're 5 miles in the radius.
Some are within a block.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah.
So what are the things that inspire you?
You know, it's interesting having been so many places. My best work is really right around home.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you have to look at it a little differently. You know, things that we see every day, you have to try to get it in the right light or a different vantage point. And show things, the things people see every day,
mm-hmm.
to them in a different way.
You know Chef Hari Cameron, when
yeah,
you
sure.
were talking about 5 mile radius, and he's become an expert on foraging and using a lot of Delaware.
Yeah, as I guess a lot of restaurants are doing.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, but I think he goes another level where he actually is the one foraging mushrooms and foraging out. So I find that wonderful.
Probably find him out in the woods someday.
That's right. You guys were passing across each other, right? It came to my attention, and I have to say I was unaware. You had an amazing happenstance while you were in Egypt, and you were meeting with Anwar Sadat the day.
Shooting the Sinai Peninsula for National Geographic.
Right.
Back after the Camp David Accords when the Israelis were going to turn over the rest of the Sinai to Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
So the plan was for me to spend the day with Sadat, President Sadat of Egypt, and I met him in his office that morning, rode with him to the parade, photographed him saluting the tomb of the unknown soldier, where he would be buried a week later. He was killed by a bunch of folks that didn't agree with making peace with Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And I was able to photograph the guy right next to me, but as close as you are, died from a hand grenade that exploded right in front of us, or an AK-47, I'm not sure. But I took one look down, and he wasn't even twitching.
He was just gone.
Right there. And I got pictures of 7 people that were killed that day. Some Americans got shot, photographed them. Belgian ambassador had his arm blown off. I did not get Sadat, but what I did have was the cover of virtually every magazine in the world.
Mm.
And Newsweek bought exclusive rights to those photographs in America, but they were everywhere, Japan, Argentina. It was the hot news item.
Wow.
And that was the same year Reagan, somebody tried to assassinate Reagan back in like April.
Right.
This was October.
Right. And that took the lead.
Oh yeah, that was the news that day.
Wow. So what are the inspirations moving forward? Like,
well, I've been kind of, like I said, my 28th book is at the printer.
Mm-hmm.
And I did BB Hospital's 100th anniversary book,
okay.
which turned out to be a larger project than I thought going into it. It turned out to be a 304-page book, which included a lot of archival stuff, a lot of text, 10 chapters, a lot of sidebars, a lot of words. So it's kind of interesting going back and finding the archival stuff. And I photographed 3 or 4 heart operations there, including one of the first east of the Mississippi, where they replaced somebody's pacemaker with a brand new thing.
Okay.
So, you know, for a photographer, that's kind of interesting to
yeah.
see.
And that's a relatively new program here. I mean, it's probably 7-8 years.
Yeah, for a while. But this doctor was certified in doing this brand new thing.
Mm.
And I believe it was the second one east of the Mississippi ever.
No kidding.
And right at BB Hospital.
Yeah. I have a good friend of mine that's the lead PA there. You probably ran into him.
Probably.
Yeah.
I ran into a lot of people.
A lot of people there. Mm-hmm. No doubt. So you got beautiful photos. I mean, you have a great picture right here. And I guess we'll probably show a number of your photographic type renderings here. But is there any one that stands out to you more than anything?
It's kind of like saying if you have 5 kids,
which yeah, what's
one's
your favorite
kid?
Right.
Well, I would know. But no, it's kind of a nice thing to go out and you were really happy with what you did the day before or
right.
the week before, and you push yourself a little harder and find something that you haven't done before.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really have a favorite.
Mm-hmm.
This is a northern cardinal that we actually turned into our very first puzzle this year. And it was one of those days when we had more than a foot of snow, so it was really tough to get around. And I thought, what am I going to do? So I went to the Nature Center at Cape and Open State Park, where they have a bird feeder. And I let all these really pretty birds come to me that day. I've been a pilot since like 1972 or three, and done a lot of flying and photographing. This is Cape Henlopen State Park, looking south towards Rehoboth Beach and Bethany Beach, and you can even see Ocean City, Maryland, which is 33 miles away. This was taken on August 3rd, and I looked the other way. When I did this, I could see Ocean City. I looked, and I could see the hotels in Atlantic City. There's some photographs that you can get just by being there at the right time, the right place. The canvasbacks all taking off at the same time was near Rock Hall, Maryland. So I had to go there three times to get that photograph. It's one of the toughest ones I did. I have 15 hours of driving to get that photograph, but I'm really happy with it. It's a remote control camera on the end of a pier, a 100-foot cord. That's a tough one to get.
Yeah, that's spectacular.
That's Indian River Inlet at sunrise. I like our jetties around here. We have a couple in Cape Henlopen State Park and, of course, two at the inlet. It just gives you a little bit of foreground for an ocean photograph.
They look like paintings.
I get that a lot. Well, Kevin, I can tell you that's one of my favorites. That's a full moon rising over one of our World War II fire control towers here. And you get exactly like one frame to get that photograph. It's taken with a 1,000-millimeter lens. And with a lens that long, you can actually see the moon moving through the lens.
Wow.
So you get one shot at it being in just the right spot. Ah, my raccoons. For the canvasbacks taking off, that was 15 hours. I had exactly 0.4 seconds to get the raccoons crossing one of the ponds in Bombay Hook. I was already photographing something. I had a 600-millimeter lens up. All I had to do was move the camera just a little bit when I saw them out of the corner of my eye. My camera shoots 10 frames a second. I got 4 frames, so I had 0.4 seconds to get that one.
Mm.
Yeah, I probably photographed snow geese. We have about 100,000 every winter, but that's my favorite. That one found some wintergrass and took off because one of the other 100,000 snow geese were going to steal it.
Oh, yeah, they were going to fight for it.
Great blue herons at Bombay Hook. It's easier to steal a fish than catch a fish. So one caught that white perch and one went after it. He did manage to keep it though.
So of all your photographs here.
Snaps.
Right. I mean, how do you remember all of your, what your camera you're using, where they were?
I can't remember yesterday, but I can remember every photo.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's a beautiful one too, though.
Self-portrait without coffee. That's a lucky one. That's the baby great blue heron. That's a great egret. That one's actually from Florida. I photographed that from a helicopter. We were going around it, and you know, I've been flying for years, but I almost got airsick because when you're looking through the lens and everything below you is spinning around, that was kind of a challenge. That was one of those mornings it snowed, and I wanted to cover as much ground as possible because sunrise light's only for a few minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So if I spent 40 seconds on that photograph, I'd be surprised.
Right.
And I think that's our bestseller.
Okay.
Things come and go on being bestsellers, but that one is popular through the years. Yeah. That was on Route 36 between Milford and Greenwood, very, mm-hmm. very close to Milford. And I had that in my head. When we had a snowstorm, I went up and got it. I've done a bunch up at Bombay Hook because they're kind of easy to get. That one you're photographing now is at Bombay Hook, right at sunrise. The sunrise light is just lighting his eye, not even the bottom of his muzzle. And complete luck on that. It's what God gives you when you go out there. And if you get really good light, then luckily, hopefully you're there and can get it.
Mm-hmm. I always feel like that with food. Everybody's always trying to go backwards, and I tend my, the way I think is forward.
Yeah,
you know, it's like, oh yeah, that was great. That was great. But
if you start thinking backwards, then you'll never get forward.
Right. No doubt. No doubt. Your hours of operation here.
Right now, we're winter hours. We're closed Tuesdays and Wednesdays.
Okay.
Every other day from 10 to 5.
10 to 5. And now, how often are you in the Rehoboth studio?
Almost never.
Almost never. So this is, you do work
almost,
out of there?
Almost never for both.
Okay.
It's occasionally, I have a staff that are very good.
Okay.
Very good at helping people pick things out. And I did 5 books this year. I just didn't have time to work in. I did like 800 pages of books as editor and publisher and photographer. So that doesn't leave a lot of time to...
Yeah.
To do retail.
Well, you're a busy
it's,
man.
It's fun. I do like coming in here. And, you know, if I take somebody's shift someday and you get to meet people and
right.
talk to them.
Yeah.
Good thing.
No doubt. Well, I appreciate you taking the time out here.
Thank you.
And I know you're a busy man and got plans for the rest of the day, I hope.
Breakfast. See, food is important.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. That is. Well, once again, I really appreciate it and continued success. And we always enjoy it.
Thanks to you, too.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Get homegrown produce packed at the peak of freshness with Pfeiffer's Delmarva Box CSA program. Become a member today at PfeifferOrchards.com. Pick from 9 or 18 weeks of fresh fruits and vegetables. Select from local meats, eggs, and cheeses, and your bountiful box of Delmarva Fresh Produce will be packed and ready for pickup at a location near you. Pfeiffer's Delmarva Box CSA program is the fresh, fun way to feed your family. Become a member today at PfeifferOrchards.com.
When Abbott's Grill throws a party, you know it has to be good. From small business lunches and cocktail parties to full-service wedding receptions and off-site catering, Abbott's Grill makes planning simple and stress-free.
We take care of every detail so you can enjoy your event.
Abbott's Grill has catering options for every budget. Call 302-491-6736 or contact Laura Burton at abbottsgrillde.com. Be a guest at your own party with Abbott's Grill Private Dining and Catering.
Hey, Eric here. Don't miss a thing at Mississippian River Brewing, the world's premier craft brewery located in Milford, Delaware. Stop on by for a sample, or a six pack, or a growler, or if you just want to stop by and have a pint. Check us out at MississippianRiverBrewing.com.
Hi, welcome back. We just had a great conversation with Kevin Fleming, and one of the dishes that he had done a photographer or a photograph of ours was the paella, and that was 15 years ago. It was ended up being one of the nicest photos of food that I've ever seen. So it kind of inspired me to kind of, you know, bring back the paella dish today. So if we could, I'll go ahead and get started. The couple ingredients that we have here is that we have a smoked chorizo. You can use fresh. We also have saffron, Spanish saffron. And this is kind of a dying art. This whole container here is probably about $125. That's probably wholesale. You might get a little cheaper, more expensive. I've heard of people paying $200 for this. And it's the it's hand-picked, and it's the crocus flower. It's the actual petals, or not petals, but the actual threads of the crocus flower. And they give an unbelievable flavor and color to it. So we're going to go ahead and get started. I have a pan going in the back. I'm going to go ahead and make my rice first. I also like to heat up my stock. I have a little bit of chicken stock in the back. And I've gone ahead and diced up about a cup of the smoked chorizo. And I like the smoked chorizo because it has a really nice paprika component, garlic and paprika component. So I put that in first. And we're going to go ahead and let that sweat, and you'll see the paprika starting to come out. I'm going to go ahead and get a little bit of onion going here, and a little small dice here. When I do my rice, I will generally, because we're usually doing it more of a bulk type of preparation, is that I'll do 1.5 liquid per rice content. So right here I have about 2 quarts, just a little under 2 quarts of basmati rice. Happens to be the rice I like to use the most. And I have in a pot here, I have just a little bit over 3 quarts of chicken stock. So when I do the rice, I like to use chicken stock. And then when I start doing the paella, I do an a la minute style cooking on the paella. I will use either a lobster stock or shrimp stock. So I'm gonna go ahead and add our onions in, as well as a little bit of garlic. I did a little chopped garlic already. I'm going to do like a little teaspoon here. You can already see the paprika leaching out of the chorizo here, giving that beautiful orange hue. I'm going to go ahead and add my rice, and we're going to toast that for a moment. As you know, I like to do that almost all the rice dishes that I do. I'll toast that, kind of get the oils going in it, coats each of the kernels, the rice kernels evenly. So I'm going to reduce that down just a hair. The rice is really starting to pull it in. I'm going to season that with a little salt and pepper mixture. I'm going to do a nice good pinch for this amount. Maybe just a touch more. Let's go ahead and add our stock. I'm going to bring up our temperature on the burner here. And as soon as it comes to a boil, we're going to reduce it down to a simmer and let that take its time. What I do is I'll check it, and when all the liquid is removed, I actually turn off the temperature, the flame, and then I'll let it kind of sit for 5 or 10 minutes, and then I'll turn it out on a sheet tray, and then I'll add the peas to it for the color and the sweetness. I like to have a nice vegetable component. I like color, obviously. So here I did a little cauliflower. This is gonna be raw. I'll probably slice that down a little bit. I've got a little green beans here and carrots. Both the carrots and the green beans I have blanched and shocked already, which is boiling water, salted water, and then you're hitting immediately into ice water to stop the cooking, and it actually, you know, pulls out the green, the chlorophyll in the vegetables. And that, if you're ever wondering why they're so, some of the vegetables are so radiant or bright green, it's usually the shocking that'll pull it out. So we have that there. I have a couple of oysters here. I was thinking about roasting them, so I'm going to go ahead and pop a couple. These are some Chincoteague oysters, so I'm going to pop a couple oysters. And what I'm going to do is actually I'm going to roast them. I'm going to put a little pat of butter in them, and I'm going to go ahead and roast them. And to open them, I guess I could have shown you that, is they have a little hinge in the back. If you just kind of take your knife into the hinge, you don't want to push. The idea is to use your wrist and snap. So I put it in, snap, and then I raise it up, and then in one motion, I take, release it from the top. It has a little connection on top, so I release that, and then I come underneath it and scoop it right there. So I've got a little pat of butter here. And we're gonna go ahead and roast these in the oven for about 10 minutes. As you can see here, we still got about 5 or 10 minutes more to go. You can still see the liquid bubbling down the bottom. I turned it down fairly low. We don't want to keep this pan off for too long, so we're going to keep that on there to keep the steaming process going. But we're getting close, about another 5 or 10 more minutes, and we'll be ready. So I went ahead and pulled the oysters out, and these have been poaching in butter, and if you could smell these are unbelievable. I have now turned off the fire to the rice. I'm going to add the peas to it, and we're going to just let it steep for a moment while I make the actual seafood type of portion of the paella. Now the paella is a traditional dish of Spain. 20 something years ago I went to Spain. I kind of had a revolutionary dining experience, the first time I ever tried it. And later on I ended up opening a Spuma restaurant, and the paella ended up being our number one dish there. Now the only difference with the paella for me compared to in Spain is that they kind of put everything together and then they bake the rice dish. And I always thought, like, with things like calamari and shrimp, it just, to me, that's a la minute cooking. Like, in 2 to 3 minutes, that shrimp is just beautiful. If you cook shrimp or calamari for, you know, 25, 30 minutes, it just ends up being a little chewy. So I kind of adapted a different style to that. So I have a couple of vegetables here. I'm gonna start, just kind of cut down a little bit of my cauliflower. And I'm gonna go ahead and add that, as well as I'm going to add a little chorizo because I want to get a little bit more flavor and color to that as well. So let's add these two things first. Chorizo and a little bit of the cauliflower. I cooked a little chicken, had some marinated chicken. Have that, have some calamari here. I'm going to take a couple pieces of the cod off here. Have a little garlic and the saffron threads as well. Gonna go ahead and add our seafood in. Pinch of salt. Do a little pinch of threads of the saffron. And the garlic I'm gonna try to get in my oil, so I kind of render it a little bit. Now this is pretty much everything in the bowl at one time. I'm going to add my calamari, my chicken, little bit of the yellow squash, a couple of the green beans. Go with 2 carrots. Add a little cherry tomato for the color. Have a little lobster stock. The idea is I want this brothy, but I want it a little more thick. I'm gonna add a couple pads of butter. So we're gonna go ahead and cook this down. Boy, this brings back a lot of memories. So we're gonna let that go. So pretty high heat, and let's see if we can reduce that down. And the flavor on this broth is amazing. So our rice is looking good. I'll go ahead and stir that around. Stir those peas into it. Now, normally in Spain, they would serve this in a what kind of like a clay cazuela, which is a kind of earthenware where you can actually put the rice in there, a tiny bit of stock, and they would put it down on the low end of an oven. So actually the bottom pieces of the rice actually start getting really crispy. And we went through so many of them at Espuma, that was always my goal, was to, you know, be able to get it where the bottom end of it had that crispiness to them. And, but that's what you're looking for. So we'll be back in just a few minutes. I'm gonna go ahead and reduce this down. All right, well, let's go ahead and plate this up a little bit. Let's add a little bit of rice to our dish. And you can see the sauce here, how it's kind of viscous. That's what I'm looking for. So we're gonna go ahead and get all of our, and we want that broth to soak right into the paella. Kind of let things land where they will land. Make sure you get all your seafood out of here. So just kind of work them around a little bit. Can't miss our extra carrot there for color. Gonna put a little lobster tail there. Let's go with a couple of our oysters here, the roasted oysters. And then we'll take a couple pieces of fresh parsley and just kind of dance them around a little bit. I think I have said them many times is that people eat with their eyes. They often know whether they like a dish before they've even tried it. With the senses, you know, they roll by and you can see the steam coming off of it. It smells incredible. And just then you go for the eyesight. Before you even taste it, you kind of, your brain tells you you're gonna like it or not. So there we go with some beautiful color. And that's our paella. Thank you to Kevin Fleming for giving us a great interview today. And stay tuned for next week's show. I'm Kevin Reading from Abbott's Grill, and I thank you for watching us. Thank you.